Like many stories of the seal people, this one is about a fisherman, a dour fisherman who lived alone and did not greatly care for anything. He was particularly unfond of seals. The way he saw it, seals were the competition. They ate fish, the same fish he spent his days trying to catch. The way he would fish was this. He had a number of buoys moored along the coast, and he would row from buoy to buoy, pulling up the net tied under it, checking the catch, then putting the net back into the sea. When he got to the end of the line of buoys, he would go back to the beginning and start again. Some days the catch was good, and he would eat and drink well. Some days not so good, but that was the fishing. And then he began to notice that the catch was dwindling away from one net. Day by day it grew smaller until all that he was pulling up was a few shells, the odd fishbone and a lot of seaweed. He had a good look at the net and noticed there were several big tears in it and that the ends of the twine showed signs of something gnawing it. "It's those bloody seals, I'll be bound," he said to himself. The seals were stealing his fish. Well, he decided he wasn't having this and that the time had come to do something about it. So the next morning, rather than checking the nets one by one, he just dropped anchor in sight of that one buoy, loosened his knife in its sheath and settled down to watch. The morning wore into afternoon, and the rocking of his boat on the gentle swell had almost lulled him to sleep when he heard a splash and a gurgle. The buoy was swaying rapidly from side to side, then it disappeared beneath the waves altogether. Taking a deep breath, he stood up and dived over the side of the boat, naked knife in hand. He saw a big seal worrying at the net. He swam down to the seal and plunged his knife into it, pulling it through the seal's flesh with all his might. Blood billowed out of the wound, making a red fog in the water. But even wounded, the seal proved stronger than the man. It wriggled and twisted and wrenched the knife handle out of his hand, then disappeared into the now murky water. Spluttering and gasping, the fisherman hauled himself back into his boat. "Well," he thought, "I might not have killed it, but that's one seal that'll trouble me no more. Problem solved." But the next day, all of his nets were empty. And the next, and the next. By the end of the week, he was running out of money and hungry as well. Could hardly be bothered to put out to sea anymore. So when a stranger came up to him in the harbour and said, "I hear a man as can lay their hands on some seal skins," the fisherman was only too ready to help. "I certainly can," he said. "I don't owe them nothing. I'll be wanting a good price, mind." "Well," said the stranger, "as to price, I can't speak to that. You'll have to come with me and meet my master." This the fisherman was glad to do, and the pair of them walked out of the harbour and along the coast path. As they reached the top of the cliffs, the stranger stopped, made a funnel of his hands around his mouth and sang, "Thunder, thunder, thunder, ho da da, yonder, 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 ho da da, hey yundunda, hey yundunda, hey yundunda, ho da da, hey yundunda, hey yundunda, hey yundunda, ho da da." Even before the stranger had finished the call, the sea below the cliffs was boiling with more sleek black seals than the fisherman had ever seen in his life. The stranger grasped him tightly by the shoulders and jumped clean off the cliff, pulling the fisherman with him. The instant the stranger touched the water, he changed into a big, powerful bull seal, and the fingers on the fisherman's shoulder became teeth. Try as he might, and he tried mightily hard, the fisherman could not break that grip, and his chest began to ache with the effort of holding his breath as he was dragged deeper and deeper. Now his chest felt as though it was on fire, and a blackness nibbled at the edges of his vision. Then he knew he was beaten, and with a gasp he opened his mouth, and the sea filled his lungs. But that is not the end of the story. After some time, the fisherman awoke. His chest ached, and his head too. He felt around him and felt damp rock. As he grew used to the dim light, he saw the stranger standing over him. The seal man helped the fisherman to his feet, then said, "There is someone I would like you to meet," and led him towards the back of the cave. There, on a rough bed of kelp, lay a young man. His chest was cut open in a wound that ran from shoulder to hip. "This is my son," said the seal man. "And if he is not healed soon, he will die." "Oh, and I believe that this is yours." And he reached down beside the bed and pulled from beneath the kelp the fisherman's knife. The fisherman was now deeply afraid and beginning to feel ashamed. "Have you brought me here for vengeance?" he asked the seal man. "What can I do to you other than kill you?" replied the Selkie. "And if I did that, would that help my son?" "No. I have brought you here to help, if you will. Only the hand that caused the wound can heal the wound." The fisherman looked at the youth, at his pale flesh and the cruel gash across his chest. He thought of how he had resented and hated the seals. But still he said, "What must I do?" "Simply touch his hurt," said the seal man. And so the fisherman bent forward and touched a trembling hand to the start of the wound on the youth's shoulder. The flesh was deadly cold. As he drew his hand slowly along the gash, the fisherman felt an icy, burning pain crawl across his own chest. But as his hand passed along, the wound closed as easily as you would close a jacket, and the flesh grew warm and the colour seeped back into it. By the time he was halfway along the wound, the fisherman could hardly breathe for the pain in his own chest. And as he reached the hip and the wound was finally closed, he fell to his knees, gasping and panting. It seemed as though his own life had flowed out of his hand and into the young seal man. He fell forward and slept, exhausted. When he awoke, he was lying on the shore at the foot of the cliffs, a little bruised and battered, but alive. He told those who asked that he had slipped and fallen over the cliffs. Some believed him, some did not. But he never told another soul that when he awoke, lying next to him on the shingle was a neat pile of his nets. Not only mended, but better than ever. And they always gave him a good catch. And on top of the nets was a creel. Inside were two of the biggest lobsters he had ever seen. From that day on, he was one fisherman that never hurt hair or hide of seal. And if he was a few fish short from one net or another from time to time, he would shrug and smile and say, "Why not? They have to live as well."
In Norway land there lived a maid, Hushbalulily she did sing. Oh, little can I my baby's father, nor yet the land that he dwells in. It happened on a certain day, as this fair maid lay fast asleep, that in and came a grey Selkie, and set him down at her bed feet. Awake, awake, my pretty maid, oh, how soundly you do sleep, for here am I, your baby's father, sitting close at your bed feet. I pray you tell to me your name, and tell me where your dwelling be. My name is Goodhill Marliner, I earn my living out at sea. I am a man upon the land, I am a silky in the sea, and when I'm far and far from land, my home it is in Sulskerry. Alas, alas, this woeful fate, this weary fate that's laid on me, that a man should come from the west of Hoy to father here a child by me. My dear, I'll wed you with a ring, my dear, I'll wed with thee. You may go to the wedding with whom you will, I'm sure you'll never wed with me. Now she has nursed his little wee son for 7 years all at her knee. And when 7 years were past and gone, he came with gold and white money. And now, my dear, will you wear the ring? With a ring, my dear, I'll wed with thee. You may go to the wedding with whom you will, I'm sure we'll never married be. I'll put a gold chain round his neck, and a gay good gold chain it will be. And if e'er he comes to the Norway land, he'll know for sure who he may be. And you will marry a gunner good, and a gay good gunner he shall be. And he'll go out on a May morning, he will shoot your son, and he'll shoot me.
And so the Selkie saw his own fate. And she did marry a gunner, and a gay good gunner was he, and he went out on that May morning to shoot seals. And when he came back, he brought with him a gold chain, and he gave it to her and said, the younger seal, he had this round his neck. She only needed to look once to see it was the chain that the Selkie had placed around her son's neck.
Alas, alas, this woeful fate, this weary fate that's laid on me. So she sobbed, and so she sighed, and her tender heart, it broke in three.